who've been away and have come back from their travels, good to have you back with us. And for anyone who's new to the church, it's good to see you as well. We trust you've had a good week. Let me encourage us to stand together. I'm just going to read some verses from Ephesians chapter 2. And it's probably one of my favorite passages. In fact, probably Ephesians is probably one of my favorite books. Although, can you have favorites in the Bible? Because it's all good. But let me just read a little bit from Ephesians chapter 2. And especially this morning, we're coming to remember what Christ has done on the cross and taking of his body and his blood and what that means for us. And it says this: "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace that you have been saved." Amen. Amen. We're going to sing of what it is that Christ has done.
And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? For me who caused his pain, for me who into death pursued. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, should die for me? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, his Father's throne above, so free, so infinite his grace, emptied himself of all beloved, and bled for Adam's helpless race. 'Tis mercy, and spirit lay fast bound in sin and nature's might. Thine eye diffused a quickening ray, I woke a dungeon flame with light. My chains fell off, and all in him is mine. Alive in him I live in him, and clothed in righteousness. Power of the blood.
Jesus, we'll never be able to thank you until we are with you on that final day in eternity with you. There we'll be able to worship you as you deserve. But even now, God, we want to pour out our hearts, pour out our thanks to you. God, we thank you that you chose to love. You continue to remain steadfast to who you are, that God is love. And that love poured itself out upon a broken humanity to the extent that you are willing to send your only son to die for the penalty that was needed to pay for the sins that we had committed. And Jesus, that you are willing to come, that you are able and willing to live that perfect life in communion, in connection with the Father, and led in the power of the Holy Spirit. And that you were willing, even though it was hard, even though it caused you grief and caused you separation from your Father that you'd never experienced before, you were willing to say, "Your will, not mine, be done." You gave your life for us. And Holy Spirit, you are with us now through the resurrection power of Jesus. And you are working in our hearts. And we cry out, "Praise be God. Glorify your name, God." We cry out, "Hosanna, be magnified, be lifted up today for all that you are and all that you've done." We give you the praise, and we come now to remember and to reflect even more upon what you've done, God, by your Spirit. Make it real. May it not just be the routines of what we do on a Sunday when we do communion, but may it be deep in our hearts today. For your glory we pray. Amen.
Would you please have a seat? I want to take a moment and welcome you to the International Church. We're thrilled that you're here. I see a few guests, and I'm thrilled that you're here with us this morning. Welcome. We do want you to know that here at the church, once a month, what we do is we take a pause in what we do, and we try to remember Christ's command, to remember regularly his death, his burial, his resurrection that won our freedom. So if you're here this morning and you're visiting, what we'd want you to know is you do not have to be a member of the church to participate as we take from his table. But what we would say is that you need to love Christ with all of your heart, soul, and mind, that you are a Christ follower, that you are following him, that you know for sure that when you die that you will be with him for eternity. If you have a relationship with him this morning, we warmly welcome you to celebrate with us as we take from his table. I just want to share with you a couple of thoughts as we prepare ourselves to do just this today. You know, Paul wrote, speaking of what we are to do, and he gives us some advice, and he tells us how to prepare ourselves. And he says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 27. He says that those who eat of the bread and they drink of the cup, that they need to be careful not to do so in an unworthy manner, or they would be guilty concerning the body and blood of our Lord. So he says, let a person so as a result examine himself and eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats of the bread and drinks without discerning what this means drinks judgment upon himself. So he goes on and he tells us to be careful to know what's going on in our hearts. You see, there's a reason we call it communion, because it's talking about actually walking every single day in communion with our Savior. And so what we want to do this morning is we want to make sure that our heart is prepared to take from his table. So I just want to ask us, each one of us, to just kind of take a moment, look in your heart, and prepare yourself to take from his table. Can we do that? Lord, we are so very grateful that you demonstrated your great love for each one of us. You first loved us. You chose to love us. You poured out your mercy and grace upon us. And you did so while we were still sinners. And you demonstrated that love by coming and dying for us, paying the penalty for our sins in your body through your shed blood. So, Lord Jesus, we say thank you, and we remember. Be pleased in what we do, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to ask if I can get a couple of volunteers to help me to pass out the bread and the wine. While they are passing the bread and the wine, I want to share with you once again from what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. I want you to allow your mind for a moment to go back to that night in which Jesus was betrayed. And in that night, as he is betrayed, he does this with his disciples for the first time. And he tells them what the bread represents. He tells them what the wine represents, and he tells us to regularly to do this, to remember his great sacrifice for us. And so Paul, speaking of what Christ did, says in 1 Corinthians 11 that he received from the Lord, that the very Lord that he met there on the Damascus Road that opened his eyes to who he truly was, he says, I received from the Lord what I'm now going to give to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, that he took bread. And when he had given thanks for it, he broke it. And in breaking it, it represented what was going to happen to his body in a few hours. And he said to his disciples, this is my body which is for you. My broken body, so that you do not have to die for your sins. I'm going to allow my body to be broken so you do not have to die. This is my body which is for you. And then he says, to take of the bread to remember his sacrifice, to do this in remembrance of me. Stefan, can you read, please?
Yes, I will. I will read from 2 Corinthians, chapter 5, verse 21. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Jesus said to take this and to do so in remembrance of his broken body. Do this in remembrance of him. Paul, as he continued, he said that in the same way that when supper came to an end, that Jesus took the cup, and he passed it around to his disciples, and he said this of the cup. He says, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. And that was extraordinary because he was talking about the fact that he made a new way. You don't have to go to the intermediary, to the priest anymore. You can come directly to the one who made you. You can come directly to God himself and have a relationship with him directly. I'm making a new covenant with you in my blood. And then he says, to do this as often as you drink it, to remember his shed blood that covers our sins forever, to do that in remembrance of what he did. Nicole, could you read for us?
1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous or the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit.
Amen.
Father God, thank you for suffering for us. For putting forward your righteous life, our unrighteous life. We thank you for your
Jesus said to remember what he did, his shed blood that covers sins once and for all, to do so by taking and remembering his sacrifice. Do this in remembrance of Jesus. Father God, we thank you so much for your Son that you willingly sent to this world to be a sacrifice for sins. We thank you that he willingly gave his life. Nobody took it from him. He laid it down. And we thank you that when he arose in victory, that our victory had been won right there, once and for all. The grave could not hold you. Death could not keep you in its sway. And Lord, our sins no longer have to hold us in their sway because you have freed them from us. And so, Lord, we praise you and we thank you. We thank you for the victory that you won. And we thank you for giving us your Spirit, as we just sung about, Lord, to reside with us every single day, to equip us and to enable us to be able to live victorious for you. Thank you for the victory that you won. We praise you for that. And we pray that you would help us to live in light of it. And we pray this now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Can I have the worship team return, and let's stand to our feet and continue to worship.
I'm just going to read a few more verses from Ephesians chapter 2. We just read, "It is by grace you have been saved." And it continues, "And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show his incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork," or we are God's masterpiece. Do you believe that? We are God's masterpiece? "We are God's masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." The reality is, we probably don't often feel much like a masterpiece, do we? Sometimes we might compare ourselves with other people and think, oh, they're kind of a bit more attractive, or they're more gifted in this way. But God says of each one of you here, if you have trusted in Christ, He has made you with a purpose. He has formed you. And he is the greatest creator of all. He is the creator. And you are made to be his masterpiece. As you are is just how he intended. If you lean into him and lean upon his strength. And so we're just going to sing a couple of songs that remind us that we belong to him. That we are who he says we are. And sometimes we need that reminder, don't we?
has a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
I am chosen, not forsaken.
I am who you say I am.
You are for me, not against me.
Oh, I am who you say I am. Oh, I am who you say I am.
The sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I am chosen, not forsaken.
I am who you say I am.
You are for me, not against me.
Oh, I am who you say I am.
I am chosen, not forsaken.
I am who you say I am.
You are for me, not against me.
I am who you say I am.
Oh, I am who you say I am.
Oh, I am who you say I am.
Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed.
I'm a child of God, yes I am.
My Father's house, there's a place for me.
I'm a child of God, yes I am.
You're a good, good Father,
it's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are.
And I'm loved by you,
it's who I am. It's who I am, it's who I am.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're
searching for answers.
Only you provide, 'cause you know just
what we need before we say a word.
You're a good, good Father.
It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Father. perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
You're perfect.
You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, you're perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, you're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you.
It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
You're a good, good Father.
It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are.
I'm loved by you.
It's who I am. It's who I am, it's who I
Go ahead and have a seat, and while we're having a seat, I'm going to go ahead and dismiss the kids to make their way to their time together. So I wanted to invite the kids to go on back to the room. I'm sure they're going to have a great time this morning. I want to invite you, if you got your Bible, to take it and open it to Matthew chapter 6, and then I want you to also open it to Philippians chapter 4. Matthew chapter 6 and Philippians chapter 4. Now, I remember about 25 years ago, I was standing in the atrium of a hotel in a suburb of Dallas, Texas, a suburb called Lewisville. And I was in a distressing time in life. I found myself without a job, not sure how I was going to make ends meet, and I was on my own. I remember calling my sister in the state of Indiana in tears, not knowing what the next steps was going to be. Full of anxiety, fears, and worries about what would come next. Maybe you identify. I remember another time about 12 years ago, getting a call from the States. Nat and I, of all things, had just left to go on vacation. We were down in an area in Bulgaria called Golden Sands, and we had just gotten to the hotel, and I got word that the man that I am the namesake of, my father, was sick. His heart was not working properly, and they were getting ready to rush him in for emergency surgery in the state of Florida to do open heart surgery to try to fix his heart. And I remember that evening, even though we were on vacation, not actually sleeping a wink until 5 a.m., until I got that call that said, he is out of surgery and he's okay. You know, many of us, maybe you today, maybe it's a financial circumstance, a health challenge. Many of us deal with a variety of different things. And as they come into our lives, they can overwhelm us. They can take over. And as they do, the things that we say we believe, they get tested. They get challenged. Well, this morning, I want to take a look at what God's remedy is for that. I want to take a look at what his answers are for those anxieties, those cares and concerns that we all have. But how do we deal with them in a way that honors Christ, in a way that truly pleases him? For those of us maybe in the midst of a financial challenge, I just want to share with you some insight from Christ. Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7, he is giving a message to a massive multitude of people on a mountainside, and it's affectionately known as the Sermon on the Mount, but as he's talking in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, he says, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he'll be devoted to the one and despise the other." You can't serve God and money. And as I shared with you a moment ago, I wanted you to open up to Philippians chapter 4 because there's a little more insight into what we're going to be taking a look at this morning when Paul was talking of his own challenges. You see, Paul, when he wrote the book of Philippians, he was actually in a prison cell. And he says the following from a prison cell of all places. He says in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6, "Don't be anxious. Don't be concerned about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And then the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." And I'm sure if you find yourself in the midst of one of those tests this morning, that's your desire as well, that his peace will overwhelm your heart. Let's pray. Father, I ask you to use your word this morning to minister to the cares and concerns in this room. I pray that as we look at your word, at your prescription for anxiety, for worry, that we would have open hearts, that you would open our eyes, that you'd bend our knees, that you'd cause us to yield to you and say, "Lord, may your will be done." Lord, I pray that for those who maybe find themselves in the midst of that test, that they would find hope, that there are answers. I pray that they would leave this room encouraged, knowing that this temporary challenge is just that, it's temporary. That you're still on the throne, you have not forgotten about them, that you still rule and reign, and that you are using these circumstances for their good and your glory. So Lord, today, bind up the wounded hearts, give courage to the discouraged, give hope to the hopeless, and Lord, may your will be done in this room, I pray. Use your word today, I pray. Speak through this vessel. Do your bidding, I ask, and I pray this now in Jesus' name. Amen. How has the current circumstances around you, around us, how have they affected you? We just came through a pandemic. Over 2 years of a lot of things that were out of our control. How about the war right next door? How has it affected you? Has your peace been disturbed? Maybe it's a personal illness, yeah. Maybe you're struggling with something that you've prayed and you've asked God to take it from you, to heal you of it, and you're still struggling with it, and you're like, "Come on, God, where are you?" Maybe it's uncertainty at work. Maybe some of the challenges in the economy are making things that you're dealing with at work really difficult, and you don't know Am I going to have my job 6 months from now? Am I going to have it a year from now? Am I going to have it on down the road to provide for my family? Do these things steal your inner peace? Do they rob you of your joy? You know, when Nat and I were about to get married, I remember very well the gentleman who married us, the pastor who did, he told us something that you really don't want to hear. And get in, Christina, I understand that's probably not what you want to hear, but the realities of it is that this is life. This is what we all deal with. And I know, as Stuart, as you and Deborah prepare, I mean, the reality is that life is fraught with problems. You'd love to think that when you say I do, everything's going to be perfect. But for those of us who have traveled that road, we can tell you there are challenges. You got to work through them. Life is not easy. After 18 years of marriage, I can say there are challenges, but honey, I wouldn't change a thing. I'll do it with you every single day. You know, the world that Jesus lived in wasn't too different from ours. It was quite similar. He even told his disciples that in this world, you will, not might, you will have trouble. There was the constant threat of war that they dealt with, the constant oppression under the thumb of the Romans. They were dealing with it all. And every day they would get up with the uncertainty that it would bring. There was the fear of sickness and disease, leprosy and other things, without the cures of modern medicine. And it created all kinds of anxieties. In a sin-cursed world, friends, I think you would agree with me, life is not easy in a sin-cursed world. There's pandemic. There's war. There's death. There's famine. There's suffering. Now, for each one of us who maybe are dealing with a health challenge, the concerns over the loss of livelihood, jobs, maybe homes, for our friends from Ukraine, even their very lives, it's causing our faith to be tested. It's causing our faith to be stretched. We prayed in January, Lord, stretch our faith. Would you agree that he's done so? I think he has. He's stretched our faith. It's being tested. And we've got to answer a few questions now. Will we continue to press forward in faith? Keeping our eyes on him, trusting him? Or are we going to shrink back in anxiety, in fear of the unknown? You see, there's something riding on your answer. It's our calling. Last evening, our girls sat down and watched a film called Risen. It's about a Roman centurion's journey of trying to investigate the risen Christ. As Jesus goes back to heaven at his ascension in the film, he tells his disciples, go into the world and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and I will be with you to the very end of the age. He gives them a calling. He gives them a commission, something to do. And friends, can I suggest to you that that mission rides upon your and my answer to those questions? Will we in faith press forward, or will we shrink back and face of the opposition, the things that we're facing? Yes, Jesus' day faced the same challenges. We face them today. And in Jesus' message to the crowd there on the mountain, he gives them answers to the things that they were facing. So I want us to answer this simple question. As Jesus was talking to them about their worries, about their anxieties, he tells them a reason, or he gives them reasons why it's foolish to worry about anything. So why did Jesus say that it was foolish? Why did he say that it was foolish to worry about anything that you may be facing, anything that I may be facing? Can I suggest that he gave them four very specific reasons? Four reasons for you and I. That it's a really foolish waste of our time to spend any time at all worrying about what we cannot control. The first of those reasons, I believe, is simply this. Number one, that it's unfaithful to your friend. It's unfaithful to the best friend that you or I have ever had. You know, Scripture describes him as our master describes him as our king, also describes him as friend. Even as king, he's known as a benevolent king, one who loves you and loves me. Yes, he's just, but he loves us dearly. He is the best friend that you or I have ever had. Why can I say that? Because Jesus describes himself in this way. He said this to his disciples. This is, we partook of the table here a moment ago, remembering that last night with the disciples. In that last night, he said to them in the garden in John 15:13, he says, greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for who? His friends. Did he do that? He did. He showed you how good of a friend he is to you, how good of a friend he is to me. But then in the very next verse, he says something extraordinary. He shows you, he shows me how we can know how good of a friend we are to him. How good of a friend are you to Jesus? He says in verse 14, you are my friends if you do what? What I command you. If you go back to Matthew chapter 6, verse 25, he starts and he says, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? What I want you to see is, as he starts here, when he says, do not be anxious, that is in the imperative. That is a command. How do we know how good of a friend we are to him? Do we do what he has commanded us to do? Are you overcome by your worries, your cares, your anxieties? If you are, and you're going in the opposite direction, shrinking back in fear and in concern, can I suggest you're not a very good friend to him? Because you will demonstrate to him how good of a friend you are by doing what he asks of you, what he asks of me to do. You see, he tells us very clearly, don't be anxious about your life, what you're going to eat, drink, about your body, what you're going to put on it. He's talking about, yeah, the necessities, the things that we need. This is completely different from cars and houses, the things that maybe we might desire, maybe a promotion at work. But the necessities of life, he's promised to take care of those. David spoke of this when he said in Psalm 34:10, he says, the young lions, they suffer want. You see some things in nature that don't always look right. But what does he say about you and I? But those who seek the Lord, they lack nothing good. He provides for you. He provides for me. And he will continue to do just that. So friends, are you anxious this morning? Does the war cause you concern? Are you worried about getting sick? Are you worried about your job? Friends, there is a friend that is closer than a brother. That's the way Solomon describes him. He is with you in the midst of your struggle. Just like the three Hebrew boys when they were thrown into the fiery furnace, he didn't leave them alone. Nebuchadnezzar comes and he says, didn't we throw three in? I see four. He was right there in the flames with them. He was right there in the midst of the struggle with them. And Jesus is with you. He's in the midst of what you are dealing with. That's what good friends do. You know, I remember some of these times when I went through some of these struggles. I got a couple of friends that I went to high school with. They're the first ones to call. They're always right there with me every step of the way. They got their funny quirks, but I'll tell you what, I've got no better friends in this world. There are people that would get on a plane tomorrow and fly to Romania to be right by my side if I needed it. Jesus is that kind of friend. He's with you in the midst of your struggle. Peter describes it this way, what he wants you and I to do. You see, we demonstrate how good of a friend we are by doing what he tells us to do. And so he tells us to humble ourselves under this one who can do for you, who can do for me what we can't do for ourselves. Humble ourselves under his mighty hand who has the power to do for you and I what we can't do. And then he's going to exalt you at the right time. He's going to lift you up out of your struggle, out of your despair, out of the difficulty. So until that happens, what does he tell you to do? Take what you're concerned about. Take those anxieties. Give them to him. Cast all your care upon him. Why? Notice those last words. He cares for you. Can I suggest? He cares more for you than you care for yourself.
Amen.
He cares for you. He is the best friend that you could ever have. So I think we can conclude that our God is a dependable friend. He is a dependable friend this morning to you and I. He is faithful to his words, and he will do exactly what he says. He can be depended upon. The first reason that it's foolish to worry is because it's truly unfaithful to your friend who has proven to be a better friend than any friend you've ever had. But the second reason that it's foolish is because it's unnecessary because of who your father is. It's unnecessary. If you truly know who he is, his character, his power, his promises, it's completely unnecessary. Verse 26. Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns. You know, it's interesting. You do see the birds. You can go out and you can look at the park and you can see the birds flying around. And you don't see them doing like the squirrels or the rodents and going and getting the nuts and putting them in their burrows for the winter. The birds just go about doing what they do. And they don't do the same thing. But listen to what Jesus says about them. He says, yet your Father feeds them all. But aren't you of more value than them? Which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to the span of his life? He says, you're worried about what you're going to eat tomorrow? I'm taking care of the birds. I'm taking care of the tiniest little rodents scurrying across the ground. I take care of the fish of the sea. I take care of them all. He provides for every single thing that he has made. Psalm 104, verse 14. You cause the grass to grow for the livestock. He provides for them, for the animals, and plants for you and I to cultivate so that we can have fruits and vegetables and things to eat, that he may bring forth food from the earth. He provides for them all. And then he says in verse 28, he continues on, he says, are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil, they neither spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Do you actually know who Solomon was? Historically, he was quite possibly the richest that's ever lived. Elon Musk has nothing to compare to Solomon. I mean, this guy had whatever he wanted. He was the wisest, richest. People from all the world were coming to Solomon. He had it all at his fingertips. And yet Solomon couldn't do what God Almighty can do. So he continues on and says, but if God, who so clothes the grass of the field, the flowers of the field, which is today alive and tomorrow it's thrown into the oven and it's cooked, will he not much more clothe you? Oh, you of little faith. He takes care of the beauty of the flowers. You know, I like going to the park just to see the majesty of the waters in the lake and the trees as the wind blows through them. I like going to the mountains to see the majesty of what God's creation looks like. It's one thing to go and lay in the cool grass at night and stare up at the stars and look at the majesty of the galaxies and to see all that God has done. He's arranged it all in a beautiful way. And do you know that he not only created it, but he continues to care for it. Nehemiah 9, verse 6. You are the Lord, you alone. You have made heaven, the heavens of the heavens, with all their hosts, the earth and all that is in it, the seas and all that is in them, and you alone, you, mighty God, preserve them all. He provides food, clothing. He takes care of every bit of everything that he has made. What about for those who love him? What about those that he calls his kids, his children, those who believe? Will he not care for you? Will he not care for me? You know, our earthly dads, generally speaking, for those of us who knew what it meant to have a father at home growing up, most of us probably experienced a dad who wanted to do good for his kids. And they might not have been able to do everything that he wanted, but clearly they want good for those that are their own. I remember literally almost 6.5, 7 years ago, in April of 2016, Natty takes our oldest daughter over to a hospital here, and they call a little bit later and they tell us that they've diagnosed our oldest daughter with diabetes type 1. And I would have done anything. She said, give it to me. Don't let her have it. Let me take that. Let me deal with that. That's what I want as a dad. But you know what? I didn't have the power to do that. I didn't have the power to do what I wanted to do. But there is one who does. Amen. See, our heavenly daddy, he wants good for you. He wants good for me. A few verses later in chapter 7 of Matthew, Jesus described how our Father in heaven wants good things for you and me when he said, which one of you, if his son asks him for bread, if he's hungry, who's going to give him a stone? You wouldn't do that. He says, which one of you, if he asks him for a fish, will give him a serpent? You're not going to do something like that. If you then, who are evil, who are bound to your sins, know how to give good gifts to your kids, how much more will your heavenly daddy, your father who is in heaven, give good things to those who ask of him? Will he not do the same? Or even more, even better? He actually says in his words that he will do exceedingly above and beyond whatever you could ever think or imagine. The reason we don't have is because we don't ask. We don't ask of our daddy and say, Daddy, I need help. Can you provide? Friends, he will. And he can do so because he has the power to do it. I couldn't take diabetes from my daughter, but he can heal her. He can take it away. He can restore. You see, he has the source of everything that we need. He's the source of all good things. It all comes from him. James says it like this in James 1:17. He says, every good gift is from above. Everything that you have that is good in your life came from him. Every good gift, every good and perfect gift comes from above. It comes down from our heavenly daddy, our heavenly father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shifting of shadow. He does not change. He is the source of all good things. So he's not just a dependable friend. Can I suggest, I think you'll agree, that our God is also a capable, he's a capable father. He doesn't just say he's going to do something. He's capable to follow through and to fulfill everything he says he will do. He will do good for you, and he'll do good for me. So, friends, it's foolish to worry because of who our friend is, and it's unnecessary because of who our father is as well. But it's also foolish, Jesus says, to have worries and anxieties overwhelm you because it's unreasonable. It's unreasonable because of the nature of your faith. If you truly believe, it's unreasonable to have concerns about what he said he controls. Verses 31 to 33, therefore, don't be anxious saying, what will we eat? What we're going to drink? What are we going to wear? Why? The Gentiles, those who don't know me, they seek after these things. Everybody does this. That doesn't set you apart as different. That doesn't make you unique. That doesn't show the true nature of your faith. You see, Jesus, when he was talking to the crowd, he made an interesting statement in chapter 5. In chapter 5, he said, he makes his son rise on the evil and the good. He makes his rain come down on the just and the unjust. You know what that means? He gives common grace to those who believe and to those who don't. He provides for the needs of all that he has made. But that doesn't show the nature of their faith because they don't have faith. But where's your faith? What shows people what you really believe? What demonstrates that and shows that to others? You know, you'd like to believe that those who don't believe that God would maybe zap them and deal with them immediately and that he would not deal with their needs, but he deals with their basic needs. David said it this way in Psalm 145, verse 15, the eyes of all look to God himself, the one who made all things. You give them their food in due season. He provides for every single one of them. And for those of us who maybe are a little discouraged because of what we see happening next door in Ukraine, we see the innocent suffer. We see unjust things being sowed upon those who don't deserve it. Can I suggest that there will be a day of recompense that will come? The Bible tells us very clearly that all are going to die, and after that will come judgment. But we wonder why it doesn't happen now. Why doesn't God deal with the president of Russia right now? Why doesn't God deal with the human traffickers right now? Can I give you the reason? Are you grateful for grace in your life? Are you thankful that he gave you mercy when you didn't deserve it? I know I am. Do you realize that same God who gave you and me what we don't deserve, he wants to give them, if they'll repent, the same thing, because they don't deserve it either. Peter says it like this. He says in 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slow about keeping his promise. He's coming again. If I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself so that where I am, you will be also. He will keep that promise. But, he says, I'm patient with you, with those who don't believe, not wanting any of them to perish, not wanting any of them to die, not wanting any of them to be separated for eternity. Why? I want everyone. That's his desire. As a heavenly daddy, as a heavenly father, he wants everyone to come to repentance, to come into a relationship with him, to know forgiveness of sins, to know a hope for eternity, to receive mercy when they don't deserve it. He wants that for everyone. That's why we still see sometimes the innocent suffer. That's why we see unjust things happen. Because our God is still gathering a people to himself. But for those of us who do know him, yeah, the Gentiles, those who rage against him, he provides common grace for all. But can I suggest to you that he hasn't forgotten you? He sees your current test. He sees your trial. If it's a financial concern about, will my job be there in a few months? If it's a health concern, am I going to live till next year? If it's a concern about the war, the pandemic, he sees your concern. And he says to that concern back in verse 32, your heavenly Father knows that you need these things. He's not surprised. He's not sitting up in head, scratching his head saying, boy, how did that happen to him? He knows what's happening. He's not an absentee God. He's involved directly. And he wants good for you. And he's at work to produce good for you. He cares, yes, for all, but he cares for his kids. And he will provide for your needs. He tells us in Philippians chapter 4, verse 19, I will provide all your needs according to my great riches and glory. And you know what's incredible about that? Is if he knows what you have need of, and he's on the case, he's not an absentee landlord, he's involved. If he's working on your behalf, that frees you. That gives you freedom. It frees you to serve. It frees you to, just as he says in verse 33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. It takes the shackles off. It allows you to help a refugee in crisis. But, Pastor, I don't know, because if I bring people into my home, I might not have money at the end of the month to provide food for my kids. He knows. Somehow he'll make a way. If you seek first his kingdom, he'll take care of it. It frees you to help when somebody has a bad case of COVID. Oh, I don't want to get close to that house. I might get cooties. I don't want that. No, it frees you to go and to provide soup for somebody who's sick. It frees you to go and show that one who's ill the love of Christ. To go and share the good news with one who maybe has only got a few hours left and the only hope that they have for eternity is to come into a loving relationship with Jesus Christ, and maybe you're the one to share it with them. It frees you to do it. Why? Because he's at work on your case. He's promised you that. He's taking care of those things for you. It frees us to serve those who are overwhelmed by the cares of this life. As we do, can I suggest he's promised to care for us? He's promised to care for you, for me. You know, David had a lot of concerns. Even though he was king of Israel, he had two sons turn against him, try to steal the kingdom away from him. He was constantly at battle, at war. There was constantly struggle during his reign as king of Israel. But he made an extraordinary statement in Psalm 37:25. He says, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor their children begging for bread. Do you believe that? He has not forgotten you, and he will provide for your current situation. So can we not agree that our God is an attentive, he is an attentive provider. He's not absent. He's involved. And he will provide for every single thing that you need. Can I give you the last reason that Jesus said that it's foolish to worry? The last reason that he says it's foolish to worry is it's unwise considering your future. It's unwise considering what's coming. Verse 34, therefore do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. I got just a quick question for you. How many of you, just by spending more time thinking about it, more energy concentrating on it, how many of you have actually been able to change the events of what's coming tomorrow, the events of what's coming next week, next month, by spending all that mental energy thinking about it? Not one of us. It's not in our control. And Jesus points this out to them. You have no control over the length of your life. He said that back in verse 27. He also said it in Luke chapter 12, verse 25. He says, which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to the span of your life? You have no control over it. David described it this way. He said that his very days had been numbered by his Father in heaven, all the days ordained for me, those that you have specifically ordained for me. They're written in your book before I even took my first breath. Before I was even a thought with my mommy and daddy. Hallelujah. You already knew it all. You took care of it all. It's not in my control. It's in your control. So it's folly to seek to control what's not in our control. Why try to grasp at the wind when it's not yours to control in the first place? You know, I once read about a man who was so concerned about the welfare of his family. Then he moved to a very rural place in America, and he built this house, and he took very special care to make sure that not only was there an alarm system, but he put in these types of walkways where there was no tripping hazards, and he made sure that the things in the kitchen were in such a way where nothing would catch on fire, and he made sure that everything was just so that there was no way a child could get hurt, nobody could take a wrong step. He thought he took every single step to do the right thing. Then one morning he awoke and one of his children had a little bit of a fever, and so him and his wife were concerned, and so they immediately rushed his child out to the car early that morning to put him in the car to take him down to the doctor to get some medicine to try to help him out. And as he's backing out, his toddler walked behind the car and took his child. He took every step that he could to avoid that happening. But it wasn't in his control. The length of our days, the things that are going to happen, they're in the hands of our best friend, our Heavenly Daddy, our loving Father. the one that we can depend upon, the one who has shown himself faithful, the one who is more than able. And he knows what's good for you and good for me. So why do we need to control what is not ours to control in the first place? Instead, he says, finally, sufficient for the day, verse 34, is the trouble of this day. So deal with its troubles. Stop worrying about the what ifs, the maybes, what might happen tomorrow. You know, I remember when I was young, all that wasted time I spent on, who am I going to marry? Who? Exactly, who, baby? God had to lead me halfway around the world to do something that I never envisioned, to do something that was so much better than I could have ever imagined. Remember all that time I wasted worrying about my receding hairline, thinking, would any girl want to have me? Remember all that time I wasted worrying about the adoption? And I think my wife will tell you, it controlled me for several years. And I think God taught me a lesson, because do you realize that the adoption never really fully came to a conclusion? And I think my wife would tell you this, until I gave it to God. It wasn't in my control. See, worry focuses on the things that we can't control. We want to be the master of our own domain. God, I want to control my health. I want to control my finance. I want to know what's going to happen a year from now. And he just lovingly whispers, I got it all under control. Don't worry about it. I'm going to take care of it. My plans are good. They're for your welfare, not for harm. I'm going to give you a future and a hope through them. Trust me. He wants you. He wants me to trust him, not to worry about what we cannot control. It's unproductive, friends. It's not using our time wisely. And it's interesting, because considering our future, that's exactly what we're called to do. David prayed this in Psalm 90. He says in the Psalm 90, verse 12, he says, teach us to number our days, that we may get a heart of wisdom. Spending undue time on things that we cannot control is not a wise use of time. Jesus makes it clear each day has enough trouble of its own, so instead of worrying about tomorrow, deal with what you have to worry about today. That would be wisdom. That would be the wise way forward. So can we conclude by saying, if God is a dependable friend, if he is a capable father, if he is an attentive provider, can we not agree that our God can be trusted then with our tomorrow, with our future? Can we not agree on that? If he can do those things, can we not trust him with what is to come, that he'll be faithful to everything he said? So I want to conclude by going back to a passage we started with. What is God's cure then for my anxious thoughts and concerns? What is the cure that he has for those things that do creep up, and they creep up in all of our lives. They creep up in your pastor's life, believe me, they do. Ask my wife if you don't believe me. She'll tell you. What is his cure for it? What must we do when we get challenged to get worried about things that we can't control? Can I suggest? The Apostle Paul, under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, tells us what the answer is in Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. Paul says there, don't be anxious about anything. Don't be concerned about the things you can't control. But in everything, no matter what it is, give it to God. By prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which we all want in the midst of test, in the midst of turmoil, in the midst of trial, the peace of God which surpasses all understanding, it will then guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Can I suggest that he gives you kind of a three-step cure? Can I give it to you this morning? First, talk to your friend. Talk to your friend. Are you concerned about things you can't control? Are you concerned about the war? Are you concerned about COVID? Are you concerned about your job, your health? Talk to him about it. He says, don't be concerned about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication. That means pray about it, but be specific about it. Tell them what you're worried about, just like you would talk it over with your wife, like you talk it over with a friend. Talk it over with him. Tell him specifically what concerns you. He wants to know. You see, which one of us who had a good earthly father, when you came to him and said, Daddy, I need to talk to you about something, said, nope, go away. Well, they say, come here, I'll listen. Come talk to me, I want to hear from you. He wants to hear from you. So talk to your friend. He is a closer friend than even the closest brother. He's the best friend that you could have. Talk to him about it. But here's the second thing you got to do. Number two, thank your daddy. Thank him. Don't just talk to him. Thank him. What are you thanking him for? Has he been good? Oh, come on now. Has God been good to you?
Yes.
He has. Do you have reason and cause to praise him, to worship him, to thank him? Yes, you do. You know what's fascinating? It's an interesting formula. The cares and the anxieties. I remember when I had all those worries about my finances and what I was going to do, and when I was worried about my dad, would he survive his surgery, and when I was concerned about the adoption or whether or not it would ever be completed. When I start focusing upon, man, he did this, and he did that, and he did that. Just like the old hymn, count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. When you do that, and you're just going on, and you're going on, and you're going on, and you're going on, and you're going on, what'd you just forget about? All those things that you were worried about. There's no room for it at that point because your heart has been overwhelmed by all the good that he's done in the past and all the good that he's promised to do in the future. So yeah, talk to your friend, but then express your gratitude to your daddy. Tell him how grateful you are for him because you know he's on the case. Just like your earthly dad was there working for your good and to provide for you good things, and you knew that if anything was to happen, he would be right there. I always knew that if I ever got in trouble, my dad would be right there, and so will your heavenly father. So thank him for it. Daddy, I'm so grateful. No matter where I'm at, you are there with me. Talk to him. Thank him. And if you do that, you know how, going back to what we learned earlier, we express how good of a friend we are to Jesus? We express that by doing what? What he says, right? What he commands. Well, if he tells us, pray. Talk to him. Let him know what you're concerned about. And then absorb yourself in praising him and thanking him for all of his goodness. He does something extraordinary. You see, the best way we demonstrate our trust is by obedience. So as we obey him and do these things, follow through by trusting your provider, the one who's promised to do all these things for you. And if you will trust him, what's he say he's going to do? The peace of God that surpasses all human comprehension. The world wants it, but they can't understand it. How can you be in the midst of a terrible war and have peace for eternity? Because of him. How can you be in the midst of a pandemic, stuck in your homes, can't get out, but still no joy? Because of him. So trust him, and as you do, you're going to see him keep his promise. You see, he told his disciples that he wanted to leave his peace with him, Not peace that the world gives, but the peace that only he can give. And he will give it to you, and he will give it to me, even in the midst of terrible trials, in the midst of terrible crisis, if we will trust him. So talk to your friend. Thank your Father. Trust your provider. In a moment, I'm going to ask the worship team to come and close our time. And Stu's going to lead us in a song that he taught to us a while back, and we've sung it occasionally. But I really think that it's very appropriate for us to use this morning as we close. The song begins with these words: "Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy as he whispers in your ear. You don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. Come on, you got to do something about it. Aren't you worried?" No. Praise is the weapon that silences the enemy. And then the next phrase says this: "Let praise be a weapon that cures all anxiety." What's he getting at? Talk to your friend. Thank your daddy. Trust him. He's provided in the past, he'll provide in the future. If we do that, friends, we can be free to seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, because he's going to take care of all the rest. Do you trust him? Let's show him how much we trust him by how we worship him. Can you join me in doing that? Let's stand as the worship team comes. Father, I pray as we lift up our voices now that it would be an expression of what we believe, that we trust you no matter what is happening around us, and may you be glorified in it, I pray. And I ask this now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Forever lift him up.
inside of me. So let it rise. Living looks like this is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven. Freedom feels like this is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever live to be mine. With all creation cry, God, we praise.
Jesus, you know our every need. You know our every anxiety. Even if we don't bring it to you, you know it, and you are so gracious so often to meet us there. But God, how much peace we often forfeit when we don't bring it to you, when we don't surrender it to you, when we don't understand your friendship and your ability to father us and to meet every need, to provide for us. So God, for those who may be wrestling right now with real struggles, God, just by your Spirit, enable them just to say, this is for you, God. I give it into your hands. I lay it at your feet. God, let faith arise in our hearts, in those moments especially. And may we live this week in active praise so that when those situations come, we have that weapon already exercised, our muscles already built with faith that we can respond in the way that we need to. God, let faith arise in your community here through this week, May praise be on our lips in every moment, in every circumstance. We pray for your glory. Amen.
One quick thing before we go. They don't even know I'm going to do this. Can you join me? Deborah, can you join me? Seventeenth, right?
Mm-hmm. A week from Wednesday.
A week from Wednesday. We're going to know them officially as Mr. and Mrs. Harrison. They've been a blessing to us, and they're going to be gone for a short period. They're going to go to the UK, where Stuart grew up at, and on the 17th, God willing, our good friend that many of us know, Jonathan Moore Crispin, who used to be here at the church as well, is going to marry them. He's going to have them take their vows together, and they'll come back as man and wife, and I think it's appropriate that we pray for them as they go. We will be praying for Gideon and Christina soon, I promise. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for, in your sovereign wisdom, many years ago, I remember those first days when Stuart and Jonathan and I got to know each other. The church was much different then. We didn't know what you had in store. We didn't know what your plans were, but that's okay. It wasn't for us to control, as we learned this morning. Lord, you've done exceedingly above and beyond anything we could ever have thought or imagined. And I'm certain Stu, as he came here, would not have dreamed that he would come to Bucharest, Romania, serve in ministry here to meet eventually his life mate, not from the UK, not from Romania, but from America, a Yankee of all places, a Texan. God, we thank you for your goodness, for your blessings. Lord, we pray as they get ready to take their vows here in a week that, Lord, you would bless their lives together. We pray that Jesus would be at the center of their home. And we pray, if you're willing, that you would make them fruitful for all of eternity. Raise up this couple, we pray, and we ask you to use them mightily for the glory of God in your kingdom. Lord, I also do want to pray for Gideon and Christina. Lord, we know on Saturday they're going to take their vows together here in this city. They're not going away. They're going to be here. And Lord, it's going to be a wonderful time as we celebrate them, the love you've given to them for one another. But Lord, I know their desire is for you. They love you, and they want you to be at the center of their home as well. And I pray that if you're willing, Lord, that you also might raise them up. Lord, who would have ever thought somebody from Nigeria coming to Romania to meet their mates? And God, I know you have a purpose in this, and you're going to do something wonderful and beautiful through it. So Lord, make them fruitful for your glory as well. Lord, we have much to celebrate. Lord, we have tasted and we have seen that you are good, and we are experiencing it again. So Lord, we praise you and we thank you. We pray that you bless both of these couples, and we pray this now in Jesus' name. Amen. What a blessing it's been to be with you this morning. God bless you guys as you go. Go in the peace of the Lord, and may he be richly at work in your life this week. God bless you. You're dismissed.